Deborah Johnson went through successful surgery a week and a half ago.
Amen.
And she's in worship this morning. Session down in the village of Harlem. You were there every night. Every time I spoke, you were there, and I appreciate it. It gives you the strength of courage to know that your people are with you. We're looking forward in September to ordaining some of our ministers. Minister Trent Elmore is in the process. I hope she's ready.
Amen. Amen.
September, Minister Paul Weather.
Amen.
And so we're looking forward to doing that. And we're going to do all of that in conjunction with Mount Carmel Baptist Church in the Bronx, Minister Shabaka.
Amen.
All three of them together.
Amen.
We're going to ordain in September, hopefully. Amen.
Amen.
I want to call your attention to the scripture that was read, Matthew 6, 1 through 9. Take heed that you do not your alms before men to be seen of them. Otherwise, you have no reward of your Father which is in heaven. Therefore, when thou doest thine alms, do not sound the trumpet before thee, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, that they may have glory of men. Verily, I say unto you, they have their reward. But when thou doest alms, let not thy left hand know what thy right hand doeth, that thine alms may be in secret. And thy Father which seeth in secret himself shall reward thee openly. And when thou prayest, thou shalt not be as the hypocrites are, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and in the corners of the streets, that they may be seen of men. Verily I say unto you, they have their reward. But thou, when thou prayest, enter into thy closet, and thou hast shut thy door, pray to thy Father which is in secret. And thy Father which seeth in secret shall reward thee openly. But when you pray, use not vain repetition, as the heathen do, for they think that they shall be heard for their much speaking. Be not ye therefore like unto them, for your Father knoweth what things you have need of before you ask him. After this manner, therefore pray ye, our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. I want to talk this morning on the subject, what is prayer? And I want to offer some guiding principles. Now, let's be clear from the very outset of this message. Prayer is not a magical formula or a deeply spiritual incantation we utter to a higher power to get our way or to bend heaven to doing our bidding. Prayer is more than whispering words in the air. It is more than just presenting petitions to God. Our problem is that even though most of us have grown up in the church from little children, we still do not fully grasp the true meaning of prayer. It is our repeated mantra, I pray and ask God for this or that, and nothing happened. He did not grant me my wish. My loved one still died anyway. My child has never been reconciled to me or the rest of the family. This is the clear indication that we have the wrong idea of what prayer truly is. One scholar writes, if, however, we perceive that prayer springs from and expresses the Christian life in all its depths of conviction and devotion, we must see that there are conditions of receptiveness on our part which must be fulfilled. If you think that prayer is more than words, then you've got to realize that you've got to meet a certain criteria before God will answer prayer.
Amen.
Do you not know what Jesus, what the writer to Hebrews said? He who would come to God must believe that he what?
He is.
And that he what?
Is a
rewarder of who?
Yes.
Them that? You got to meet that criteria. You must believe that God is. There ought not be any doubt in your mind whether or not God exists.
Yes, sir.
You ought not be wishy-washy. But you must believe that God is a, that God is a rewarder. And that means that if you want God to reward you, you got to diligently seek him. Don't take this as haphazard. I don't feel like praying today, but God knows my heart. Stop that mess. We must believe that prayer is more than words. But you see, for the most part, many of us are not, forgive me for saying this, but many of us are not fit to receive the Lord's blessings. Why do you say that, preacher? Because there are those of us, it's like when God blesses us, it goes to our head. One's pearls before spines. But why do we want God to bless us and then we go around acting like we did it on our own?
Talk about it.
Well, I pulled myself up by my own bootstraps. Who gave you your boots? God wants us to understand what prayer truly is. He wants us to, He wants to shower gifts upon us. He wants to walk with us in friendship and love. He wants to enter into our heart in a fresh, new, bold way that will let us know that we are now fit to receive the gifts He wants to bestow. But beloved, until you get your heart right. Well, preacher, I come to church every Sunday, so what? I was struck with a fact the other day when I was studying, and I've never really considered it. But the writer said that when Cain and Abel brought their offerings unto the Lord, you have to realize that both of them were religious. And I paused. I've never considered Cain to be religious. But the fact is that he did bring an offering unto the Lord, and therefore he must have been religious, but he was not truly convinced of the goodness of God. So we can be religious. We can come to church. Every time the doors of the church open, we can be present. We can preach in the pulpit. We can sing in the choir. We can usher at the door. We can be a deacon. We can be a deaconess. We can count the money as a trustee. We can be a pew member. And never be converted. And because of that, we really do not understand the power nor the majesty of prayer. Well, let me hasten on. Jesus wants us to know, first of all, what prayer is not. Here's what he says. Be careful not to practice your righteousness in front of others to be seen by them. If you do, you will have no reward from your Father in heaven. So when you give to the needy, do not announce it with trumpets, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and on the streets, to be honored by others. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward in full. But when you give to the needy, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your giving may be in secret.
Amen.
Then your Father, who sees what is done in secret, will reward you. And when you pray, do not be like the hypocrites. For they love to pray standing in the synagogues and on the street corners to be seen by others. Truly I tell you, they have received their reward in full. One is surprised with Jesus' teachings on helping the needy, aiding and assisting the poor. But you see, beloved, in Jesus' time, it was generally believed that giving money to help the poor, doing charitable deeds, was especially pleasing to God. We hear tell of wealthy benefactors like Bill Gates and others who give large sums of money to help the poorest in our communities.
Just a few months ago, a wealthy black businessman, Robert F. Smith, promised to pay Morehouse student loan debt owed by the nearly 400 graduating seniors. Amen.
Amen.
And they said that it of the class of 2019. And immediately we laud his name and attribute to him greatness because he was giving nearly $40 million to help African American graduating seniors at Morehouse College. Many want to hail him as a saint because of his generosity. Jesus says that if you're going to do good, do not do it so that men can see your good works. There is no merit in God's eyes. If you do it so that men can see your good works and give you credit for having a magnanimous heart, then Jesus declared, you have your reward in full. Don't serve in last lunch so folk can see you. Don't serve in the food pantry so folk can see you. Serve because you love the Lord. Serve because you love the people. We do what we do because of who God is. If we do what we do because we want folk to think that we are so great, Jesus says, your reward is now. There's nothing waiting for you in eternity. You got it now. Enjoy it while you can. But don't come crying to me and say, is there a blessing for me in eternity?
Yes, sir.
Now, before you turn away and I say I want nothing to do with this Jesus, you need to know that what the wealthy people of first century Jerusalem were doing was denying the nature of personal relationship with God. They sought a public rather than a private relationship. They wanted to be seen as pious men and women. However, God was not anywhere near. They wanted public rather than a private relationship with God. They were not attempting to please God. They wanted to showboat their wealth to the world. Jesus takes this stance against public display of piety and applies it to our prayer life. Jesus warns us against being hypocrites. Just as hypocrites love to do charitable deeds to be seen of men, there are some men and women who love to pray in public so that folk can talk about, oh, they know how to turn a phrase. Are they such great and pious and spiritual men and women? Child, don't you hear how they pray? And some people think that prayer's got to be long. I remember visiting one of our deacons in the hospital years ago, and he said to me, he said, Pastor, you need to teach your deacons how to pray. I said, Deacon, what you talking about? He said, I was feeling halfway decent.
until the deacon came in. He prayed for me for 20 minutes. Say, by the time he finished, I was worn. God does not look at the amount of words you use. God wants you to realize that you ought to be able to talk with him.
Amen.
So Jesus presents the first positive principle of prayer. When you pray, go into your room. Close the door. Pray to your Father who is unseen, that your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. Do you have a secret relationship with God? Do you know what it's like to go down by the Newway station in your own home and talk to the Lord? I'm not talking about coming to prayer meeting. Yes, there's a place for public prayer meeting. But if you want to prevail with God, you've got to learn how to do it on your knees, in your closet, in your house. Coach, you're not doing it to be seen.
Come on now.
You're doing it because you know that God has promised to hear you and to respond. For you see, beloved, it is a one-on-one relationship between the believer and God that Jesus is really having us to consider today. Do you know God? Can you talk with God? Can you have a little talk with Jesus? Can you tell him all about your trouble? Do you realize that if you do it, he will hear and answer prayer? I want to let you know that God wants you to be able to call upon him. God wants you to be able to lean on him. God wants you to be able to trust him. God wants you to be able to walk with him. God wants you to be able to know that he will make a way for you. God wants you to know that if you seek him in private, he will reward you in public.
Yes, Lord.
Now, there's some folk who want people to praise him because they can pray. It's not that Jesus doesn't want us to pray in public, but he says you got to be careful for mixed motives. One of the things that you and I are guilty of, and I tell you, you and I are guilty of it, is we have a tendency to love praise. Mm-hmm. Yes, say amen, life. We love praise.
Amen.
You know, I had to get to the point in my own walk with God where I stop asking folk after I preach, how did I do? Sometimes when I think I did well, I flunked. And sometimes when I think I flunked, I pass. But you see, it's not me. It's God.
Amen. It's good.
And if you're going to walk with God, then you've got to learn how to trust God to take care of you. Now you can't pray publicly and expect God to answer you when you're looking for the praises of men.
The second principle is a negative principle. Prayer is not vain repetitions. And when you pray, do not keep on babbling like pagans, for they think they will be heard because of their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask Him. The Greek word translated vain repetitions mean continuous babbling. Jesus teaches that many pagans believe that one should use many words in addressing their deities. But Jesus reiterates that a prayer is not heard because of the multitude of his words, but by the depth of one's conviction. Too many believers today buy into pagan assumptions about prayer. Our prayers are not content heavy. What do I mean by using the phrase content heavy? When we pray, we are not telling God about a situation that God is not aware of. Father, I need you to go over to the hospital. Sister so-and-so is there, and she's on her last. God, you may not know it, but I'm having trouble on my job. And I need you to step in and deal with my supervisor.
If your son asks for bread, given stones? If you know how to give good gifts to your children, don't you know that God knows how to give good gifts to you? Don't you know that God wants to bless you? Don't you know that God wants to prosper you? Don't you know that God wants you to be a child of His and be able to talk about what it means to be a child of God? How God makes a way for you. How God opens doors for you. How God makes your enemies your footstool. Can I get a witness? Amen. Don't you know that God is your Father? Amen. So when you approach God, you ought to approach God in faith. When you approach God, you ought to approach God believing. When you approach God, you ought to approach God resting on the fact that God says that I will do whatever you ask of me. What do you mean, Jesus? He says, ask, and it shall be given. Seek, and ye shall find. Knock, and the door shall be opened to everyone that asks. Well, preacher, that's not been my experience. It's not been your experience, because you ask, but you don't ask in faith. You don't believe that God can do it. Well, preacher, you just don't know. Let me tell you something. Jesus says that if you have the faith the size of a mustard seed, you can look at a mountain and say, mountain, be moved, and that mountain will get up from there.